Students, good morning. I hope you all are safe at home, and we are back again to our regular classes. So I hope you all wrote the exams well and you will get nice marks too. So we are discussing the chapter Mechanics of Solids, and we have discussed a few things there. So a little more is there to complete the lesson. So today we are moving to a topic called the stress strain behavior of a metallic wire. Okay, this is study. It's a study with the help of a graph that we are comparing the stress and strain. The stress means the force, the restoring force acting on a body when we apply a force, and strain means the change that is happening in that body. Okay, so there is a comparison between the stress and strain. We are taking an object or a body like metallic wire, then we are applying stress to it. Strain is happening in that body. So we are going to have a comparative study of the stress and strain, and we are plotting a graph, and we'll look into the details. Okay, so our topic is stress strain curve. Stress strain curve. For that we are taking a metallic wire. Okay, a metallic wire is taken. And you know that when you apply a force to a body, when you are applying a particular force to a body, that force is known as which force? Deforming force, isn't it? That particular object will deform or change its shape or size, whatever it is. But there is a restoring force developed inside the body in order to come back to its original position. So that restoring force acting per unit area is known as what? Stress, isn't it? For example, if you are taking a rubber band, you are stretching it, means you are applying a particular amount of force, which we call it as deforming force, isn't it? Then that rubber band will develop a force in it, which is known as restoring force. That restoring force acting per unit area is known as what? It is known as the stress. Clear? So this particular force that we are applying to the body will change its shape, and that change, it can be the change in length, it can be change in volume. So according to that, we have studied that there are various types of strain. Okay, so here we are taking a metal wire. Okay, so there is a metal wire with you. A metal wire is there. Then you are applying a load to it. Okay, this is your load. In our laboratory, we are doing an experiment like helical spring. That in that case, we are using a spring, and at the bottom of the spring, there is a hook in which we are applying different amounts of load or weight. Okay, there is a weight hanger, and we will place 50 grams each. At each observation, we will change the value of the load, and then we will measure how much strain is happening inside or how much that spring elongated. Like that. Here we are taking a metal wire, then you are applying a certain amount of load. Understand? So you can see that this is actually the study that we have made with the help of a metal wire and load. And then we got a graph like this. It's very important. A graph like this. Listen properly. The first part, that is O to this point, is OA. Let it be OA. Okay. This part is actually a straight line. That means that when you apply load to a metal wire, so that the load that you are applying is the force that you are applying, that is a deforming force. At that time, the load will the wire will develop a which force? Restoring force, that is called the stress. You know that to a particular limit, this deforming force is equal to restoring force, isn't it? So that restoring force and the deforming force are equal, which means that up to that limit, whatever force you are applying, that will be regained, or that original position will be attained by that metallic wire. Isn't it? So when you apply a force, a strain is happening there. That is, when you apply a stress, a strain is happening there, but it will come back to its original position when you loosen the force, or when you change the force, when you change the load. Understand? When you apply a force, there is a strain happening inside the wire, but when you are not applying or when you are changing that particular force, the body will regain its original shape. That is called elasticity or elastic behavior. So here this straight line indicates that the stress is directly proportional to strain, but only up to the point A. Understand? Up to the point A, stress is directly proportional to strain. Okay, you have studied a law which gives the relationship between stress and strain. What is that? Hooke's law. What is that? Within the elastic limit, stress is directly proportional to strain. Elastic limit you have studied, isn't it? So here also, up to the point A, this stress is directly proportional to strain. So how much stress you are applying, a strain is happening there. If you are reducing the stress, the strain is also reduced. It is equal, no, directly proportional. Understand? But after the point A to a point called B, after the point A to the point called B, you can see that there is a small curve produced than this straight line. Isn't it? There is a small curve. So second point, you can take it as AB. So this OA, Hooke's law is obeyed. Hooke's law is obeyed. Now this AB is a small curve. So what is happening there actually? That is, in this particular point AB, you are applying a stress. Clear? You are applying a stress and a strain is produced, but it is not directly proportional. That means you are not getting a straight line. You are applying a stress, strain is produced, but it is not directly proportional. That means if you are changing that particular force or load, the strain is also changed and it comes back to its original position, but it is not obeying the Hooke's law. Clear? So up to the point B, that is from O to the point B, you can say that this wire shows the property of elasticity. Okay, so here this O to B is actually called the elastic region. Understand? O to B is called the elastic region. Now this A is called the proportional limit. A is called the proportional limit. Now B is called the elastic limit. B is called the elastic limit. Or it is also known as yield point. Okay. Y-I-E-L-D. That is yield point. This much is clear for you. So you just imagine you are taking a metallic wire. You are applying load, which we call it as stress. Okay. When you apply stress, there is a change in the shape of the wire. But when you are changing the load or when you are removing the load, that particular wire comes back to its original position. So always there is a direct relationship or direct proportionality between the stress and strain. Up to the point, which point? A. Understand? So if you are drawing a graph like this, you will get a straight line. That means it obeys Hooke's law there. Stress is directly proportional to strain. But Hooke's law is obeyed only up to the elastic limit, isn't it? So I can call this A as the proportional limit. But again, if I am increasing the load, if I am increasing the stress, it comes back to its position, but it doesn't obey Hooke's law. So I call this A as the proportional limit and B as the elastic limit. That means up to B, it is showing the elastic behavior. Understand? Now this B is also known as the yield point. Now another term is the stress corresponding to this yield point. Stress corresponding to the yield point is known as yield strength. These are all one mark questions. So be careful. Understand and study. That is easy for you. That is yield strength. So what is yield strength? The stress corresponding to which point? Yield point. Or stress corresponding to the elastic limit is known as yield strength. Understand? Now, beyond the point B. Okay, up to B we explained. Beyond the point B, we can see that with small stress, large strain is produced. Okay? beyond the point B, the strain increases rapidly than stress. The strain increases rapidly than stress. Understand? Then, if I change this stress back to zero, okay, if I change the stress back to zero, you can see that the shape or the size that the metallic wire already changed will not come back to its original position. That means in the graph I can show a dotted line like this. That means even though I make the stress to zero, this much strain is produced permanently. Okay, the metallic wire has a permanent set inside that. That is, even though I change the stress or even though I reduce the stress, the position or the shape that already changed will not change. It will be permanently set. Okay. So, this much strain is produced inside, which we call it as residual strain. Which we call it as the residual strain. So, the fact that the stress-strain curve cannot be retraced by reversing the strain is known as elastic hysteresis. Again, important. That is, a residual strain is produced inside the metallic wire, which will result in the permanent set of the shape of the wire. Okay, the length increased. It cannot be returned to its original position. Understand? Now, this elastic hysteresis means the fact that the stress strain curve cannot be retraced. That means if it can be retraced, means I can draw in this position back to zero. Understand? But when I change this stress to zero, the strain remains in that. Strain is there. Permanent set is there. A little bit of change happened there, which we call it as permanent set. And that strain produced in the body is known as residual strain. So it will not come back through this path. It will come like this. There is a dotted line I can show there. So you understood? Okay. So first we have a metallic wire. You apply stress. Then when you remove the stress, you can see that the metallic wire come back to its original position after its elongation. This will continue only up to the point A. That is, Hooke's law is obeyed in that particular region OA, which we call it as the proportional limit. Understand? Now, after that, if again I am increasing the load, means if I remove the load, again it is coming back, but it is not obeying the Hooke's law. So, up to B, we call it as the elastic limit. Up to the elastic limit only it is obeying, right? That is the elastic behavior. So, from O to B, we can call it as the elastic region, or it shows elastic behavior. Okay. Now, after the point B, with small change in stress, you can see that there is only small change in the stress, but large strain is produced. Okay. That is, the change in the strain is rapid or rapidly increasing than stress. So, if I change the stress completely to zero, if I reduce the stress back to zero, the strain, there is a little bit of strain produced in that. That is, it is not coming back through this path. Okay. There is a little strain produced permanently in the body. That is called the residual strain. Okay. So, the body has a permanent set at the point C. Okay. At the point C. So, at the point C, we can say that the body has a permanent set. Okay. What is that? It is permanent set. At the point C. Elastic hysteresis means the fact that the stress strain curve cannot be retraced back through the original path. It's known as what? Elastic hysteresis. This much is clear. Now listen. After the point C, large strain is produced inside the wire, even though we are applying the small amount of stress, or if you are not applying stress also, large amount of strain is produced. That is, the length of the wire goes on increasing. Understand? And finally, when it reaches a point called D, it breaks. So at the point D, the wire breaks, and the wire, that point is called the fracture point. It's called the fracture point. So from B to D, you can say that the body attained another shape. It cannot come back to its original shape. That is, this region you can call it as the plastic region. Understand? This region is known as the plastic region. Clear? So from O to B is the elastic region. From B to D you can call it as the plastic region. In between you have studied certain words. They are proportional limit, that is the point A, up to where Hooke's law is obeyed. Then up to the point B, elastic behavior is shown, that we call it as the elastic limit. Then residual strain means a strain produced inside the metallic wire by applying stress. That is, after the point B, after the elastic limit, when you apply a small stress also, large strain is produced, increased, the strain is increased. So it will not come back to its original position even though we are reducing the stress to zero. So a residual strain is produced inside the body, which will make permanent set. Permanent set means the shape is, or the length is increased, the shape is changed. That is what meant. It cannot be, it will not come back to its original position. Understand? Then again, from this point C, after this point C, if you are increasing the load or if you are increasing the stress, means large amount of strain is produced. If you are not giving stress also, the length will goes on increasing. And finally, at the point D, the wire will break. That point is called the fracture point. And the stress corresponding to this particular fracture point is called the ultimate strength, or tensile strength. So two terms you have studied here. First is yield strength. Yield strength means the stress corresponding to which point? Yes, the stress corresponding to this yield point or the elastic limit is called the yield strength. And second is tensile strength, which is the stress corresponding to the fracture point. At that point D, it will break. Understand? So this is all about the stress strain curve. Again, I am saying it is very important. So understand and study each and every point can be asked, like 1 mark questions, 2 mark questions. Application questions are also asked in this section that I will discuss while we are doing numericals. Okay. So now let us move to the next portion. So based on this stress strain curve, we have to distinguish between ductile and brittle materials. You may have heard the word brittle. Glass is brittle. You have heard that. So ductile and brittle materials can be explained with the help of this graph. That is, ductile materials means materials which have large range of plastic region. Okay, materials which have large range of plastic region, I will explain. And brittle means which have very small range of plastic region. Understood? So ductile means materials which have large range of plastic region, and brittle materials having very small range of plastic region. So with the help of graph, you can explain, like in our previous graph, you have seen a figure like this. Okay, so this is our proportional limit. Then this is our elastic limit. So permanent set, and this is our fracture point. So this is the elastic limit, isn't it? Elastic limit. Now up to this, elastic behavior is shown. Then here it is the fracture point, and this region is the plastic region, isn't it? So after the elastic limit, there is a large range to reach the fracture point, isn't it? After the elastic limit, it shows a large range of plastic region, or large area covering the plastic region. Okay, so in such cases, The wires can be drawn into thin wires. Okay, that means even though it doesn't come back to its original position, it can be beaten and beaten so that it will show the plastic behavior to a wide area, to a large area. Understand? So, examples, silver, copper, aluminium, etc. These can be drawn into wires. How? Because it shows a large region having plastic behavior. So that is called ductile materials. But in the case of brittle materials, if we are drawing the graph, it will be like this. So this is the proportional limit or elastic limit. Then up to this, this is the fracture point. Okay. So this is the elastic point. Now listen, from this elastic point or from this elastic behavior to the fracture point, there is only a very small region which exhibits the plastic property. So what does it mean? That means suddenly it attains the elastic limit, it is going to the fracture point, that is that particular material will break soon. Examples, glass, isn't it? Glass, ceramics. So these are all examples for brittle materials. That means the materials which break easily. In terms of stress strain curve, if you are explaining, you can say that there is a very small range or very small region showing the plastic behavior. After the elastic point, it suddenly reaches the fracture point. Understand? So that is what the distinction between ductile and brittle materials. So in this case, also application questions are asked with the help of the graph. Okay. So this is another term that we have to define in this context, that is elastomers. Okay, so elastomers means the materials which can be elastically stretched. The materials which can be elastically stretched to large values of strain. To large values of strain. So what does it mean? I will give one example. Best example is rubber. Rubber is an elastomer. Okay, that means you know that you can stretch it to large times to its original length, isn't it? It can be stretched to multiple times with its original length, and when we remove the force, it will come back to its original position. So such materials which can be elastically stretched to large values of strain, understand? To large values of strain. That means by applying small force also, large strain is produced. In such cases, the Young's modulus will be small. Young's modulus will be very small. Young's modulus, you know. Young's modulus is given by stress by strain, isn't it? If the strain is more than stress, you know this value will be small. So in the case of an elastomer, the Young's modulus will be very small. There is no well-defined plastic region in the case of an elastomer. So, in the case of an elastomer, there is no well-defined plastic region. You can stretch and stretch, and after a particular limit, it will break. Okay. Actually, it is not obeying Hooke's law. It will come back to its original position, but it is not obeying Hooke's law. So, it can be elastically stretched to large values of strain. So, such materials are known as elastomers. And rubber is a very good example for elastoma. Then in our human body, you know, aorta, it is the largest blood vessel that is carrying blood from the heart, you know that. So this is also an elastomer actually. Okay, aorta is also an example for elastoma. So that's all about elastomers. Elastomers means the materials which can be elastically stretched to large values of strain. Here there is no well-defined plastic region. You can stretch it and stretch it compared to its original length. And when you remove the force, it will come back to its original position. But after a particular limit, it will break. Okay? It is not obeying Hooke's law, but it will come back to its original position. In such cases, the Young's modulus will be very small. As you know, Young's modulus is equal to stress by strain. And strain is very large, which means that Young's modulus must be small, isn't it? So in the case of elastomers, the Young's modulus is small. Clear? Now we'll move to the next term. So next term that we are discussing is elastic after effect. Elastic after effect. There is a delay in regaining the original state by a body on the removal of the deforming force. That means what? You are applying a force. Okay. Then you are removing the force. The body will come back to its original position. But some materials will take more time to come back to its original position. Okay. If the elastic after effect is very small, if the elastic after effect is very small, which means that the delay is very small, isn't it? So it will come back to its original position soon. And if the elastic after effect is large, means the delay is also large. That is, it takes hours to come back to its original position. Okay. So what is elastic after effect? It is a delay in regaining the original state by a body on the removal of a deforming force. Understand? The delay in regaining the original state by a body on the removal of the deforming force is called elastic after effect. For some materials it may be large, and for some materials it may be small. If it takes more time to come back to its original position, I have to say that the elastic after effect is large. Okay. If the elastic after effect is small, means it will come back suddenly to its original position. Clear? Next is elastic fatigue. Fatigue, the word fatigue means what? Kshina. Okay. Elastic fatigue means what? That is, the loss in the strength of a material caused due to the repeated alternating strains to which the material is subjected. That means, you know that any material, if you are applying more and more force on it at a particular time or at a particular point, it loses its strength, isn't it? It loses its strength, and at that time it will result in elastic fatigue. Understand? So the loss in the strength of a material, how it result in the loss in the strength? Because of the continuous use, because of the repeated use. Okay, that is why the bridges are declared unsafe after long use. You have seen such boards and all these bridges are not safe to use, like that boards are there. Why? Because bridges we are using continuous times, repeated use in the bridge will result in the collapse. Okay, so after a long time or after long use, it will result in the elastic fatigue of that particular bridge. That means it loses its strength, and that result in elastic fatigue, so that it is not safe to use. The bridge will collapse. Understand? So that these are all applications that are related to this elasticity. In the next class, we will discuss more applications of elasticity, and we have to study one important derivation also. So today I think it's time to wind up. Read the text and complete the notes, study it properly. Okay, so have a nice day and thank you.